If you've ever existed, you may have noticed the way people pair off with each other and then lay down in horizontal positions and paw away at their squalid underhinges. It's all part of a popular social interplay, which the humans call love. People have been attempting this love for dozens of years now. But of course, not everyone is invited to this frenzied, slap-hazard genital gauntlet. Tonight's story is about a man who never had time for love, mired in medical maladies and material matters. But tonight, on the very last day of his life, he's going to enter into a cast iron relationship with a woman so hot she has to have a vent affixed to the side of her head.
Like a real woman.
Enjoy!
This man is going to kill himself today. Before the sun sets, he will be dead. But how he dies? Intended method. His name is Rank Spunt, retired security guard. He lives alone in a dirty one-bedroom apartment cluttered with comic books and medical supplies. It's morning now, but the apartment is still dimly lit. The only view his windows provide is the identical apartment building across the driveway. To secure his privacy, he keeps his dusty alabaster slats shut. He braced himself against the sink as the pain of his osteoporosis climbed his withered spine, almost buckling under his broken, blood vessel-battered legs. His whole body hurt. All six of his decades hurt. Rank was born with asthma and a weak heart that was too small for his frame. As a child, he spent a lot of time sick at home, and his parents' apartment didn't have a television. So he spent his recoveries reading comic books. Spent 4 years of his puberty wearing a metal contraption to straighten his back, but it never worked. He dropped out of school in the 8th grade, believing his ailments were a burden on his struggling family. He started working. He shined shoes in the building of a law firm. He painted the fences around cemeteries. He made life easier for his parents to raise his little sister, Sharon. But he still cost a lot of money to raise. In his teens, he often caught pneumonia or was bedridden with hernias. But soon after, he landed a good-paying job downtown, on the assembly line at Way Out Windows, assembling panes and frames. After a few years, he even started to get medical insurance. His parents were very proud of him, and he was proud of himself. Rank worked at Way Out Windows for almost 2 decades. Until they slowly started laying off workers and moving more and more of their production overseas.
Until finally he got the chop.
He lost his job just after finding out he had a kidney stone. Or maybe, as he thought, because of it. He was young, sick, and unemployed, living in his parents' 2-bedroom apartment, and his mother's own health was declining. But then, Rank got his favorite job, working at the Aeronautical Museum. He was a security guard. Walking the halls at night, he gazed in wonder at the remarkable craft. They could fly like superheroes. Rank always wanted to fly in a plane,
but he never got the chance.
He considered himself lucky enough to simply protect these retired heroes. During his time at the museum, his little sister, Sharon, worked her way through college and moved out. Shortly thereafter, their mother died of breast cancer. Their father died a few weeks later, died quite suddenly, like he just refused to wake up one day. Rank continued living in the apartment where they died. Alone for the first time, he stayed for years, till he couldn't afford the rising rent anymore, and he had to downsize somewhere else. Although he had no idea how to find a home. His sister helped him get an apartment in the building across from hers. That's his current location, with the view of another building, the building she lives in. He still had his job at the Aeronautical Museum. They even paid for his prostate surgery. But a couple years ago, he was asked to retire early, and he hasn't worked since. His sister still helps him. She's a government social worker, and has set up several assistance programs for some of his expenses. With that, Rank is just about able to get by. He lives simply, spending his retirement rereading old comic books. He can't afford new ones, but he doesn't like them anyway. There's plenty of perfectly good old ones on hand because he never threw any away. Although lately his macular degeneration has made them much more difficult to read. Rank hated being retired. He was no longer of any use to anyone.
Even his own body had given up on him.
Every day, there was a little more physical pain and a little less physical money. He wished he could help someone, like his sister or her daughter.
He recognized that sound.
That horrible old rattling contraption without a working catalytic converter. He put down his kill pills and limped over to the window, peeking through the dirty blinds. He could see it. The vast lime green Pontiac was parked between the buildings, four stories below, still clattering and belching out smoke.
Perhaps he should just ignore him,
he thought. Not get upset. After all, he was only a problem for people who would be alive tomorrow. Like Sid. But if that loser was down there, she was too. He liked Sid. It would be nice to see his niece one last time. So he threw on his parka coat and a shoe, and he hobbled carefully down the stairs and out into the snow-strewn parking lot. Sid and Rank's eyes caught each other. She was just about to get into her boyfriend's Pontiac.
Uncle Rank, I haven't seen you in weeks. You look terrible. What happened to your foot?
Gout. I got gout.
Gout? Do people still get gout?
Well, I got gout.
Oh. Your hair is a mess too. Do you want me to give you a haircut? I don't mind.
Never mind my hair. I want to know for why that thing is back there.
The thing in question was Sid's strange, estranged boyfriend. His name was Pinch Hazard, or at least that's what he called himself. He often brags about being the drummer in a band called Death Joke, although he was actually kicked out last year after assaulting a bar owner with a wall-mounted jukebox. Pinch sneered at Rank from the safety of his clanking old car.
I know. But he texted me and he was apologizing.
Apologizing for putting you in the hospital? You're gonna end up there again. You said you were going to stay away from him after that. Promise your mother. He's at work right now, trying to provide for you.
I know. Believe me, I know. And please don't tell her about this.
So, she doesn't even know this jerk face is back?
Not yet. Please, Uncle Rank.
Stupid jerk face. Are you giving him money again?
No!
You're supposed to be saving up for college. You're going to be a botanist.
Biologist. But yes, I know. I'm not giving him any money, I swear. How are you? Do you need anything? I can talk to Mom if you need anything.
I don't need any money. You need it more than me. I'm never gonna take anything from anyone. I promise you that.
Okay.
There was an awkward pause as they stood across from each other in the parking lot. Rank actually did want something from Sid, but he didn't know how to ask for it. An era elapsed as they stared each other down. The trance was only broken by Pinch, who banged his fist on his car door. Rank grimaced at the punk in the Pontiac, and then back at his innocent niece.
Actually, there is one thing you can do. Can I?
What? Uncle Rank, I gotta go.
Can I, have a hug?
A hug? I mean, yeah. Yeah, of course.
Uncle and niece embraced. Her warmth filled his failing heart. Rank couldn't even remember the last time he was hugged.
Maybe at his retirement a few years ago.
But this was different. This was the best hug he ever had. This, he knew, was his final hug. One last moment of affection before he succumbs to the hereafter.
Don't tell Mom about Pinch.
I won't. I promise.
Thank you. I love you. Take care of yourself.
Goodbye, Sid. Have a very good life.
No more delays, no more distractions. This was the moment he had prepared for. Sitting on his kitchen table was $8 and a handful of loose change, literally all his money in the world. It was there, waiting for his sister to collect upon his death. Next to it was his suicide note. And he was in crippling agony. He had been saving up his painkillers for this. He mixed them all up in his bottle with whatever other pills he could find in his cupboards. He was pretty sure it would kill him. It was a lot of pills. Rank heaved a sigh and threw the entirety of the capsule cocktail in his mouth. His cheeks swelled. The little pills caught in his uncapped cavities. The big pills lodged under his tongue, which he swept around to rein in the chaos. But they were in. The deed was done. No turning back now. He just had to sit back and wait for the pills to kill him. He had no idea how long that would take, nor did he have any idea what to do with his remaining time. He decided to read a comic book, but it had to be an important one for such a momentous occasion. He started reading his replica issue of the first Superman, but he never really liked it. He didn't want the last comic book he ever read to be one he didn't really like. Instead, he started reading the issue in which Superman died. He liked that one much more. Squinting through his reading glasses, Rank started to lose himself in the narrative as his stomach growled and his faculties began shutting down. He stroked his beard and pretended it was someone else's hair. No one in particular, just anyone else. It would be nice to stroke someone else's hair as he died, he thought. To have a moment like that would mean so much. Rank never had an opportunity for intimacy. He spent his entire life in hospital beds, or working to pay his debts to those hospitals. He often wondered if love was real, like in the stories. What could that possibly feel like? Rank realized he was having trouble following the words in his comic book. He put it down in favor of a new endeavor. He picked up his scissors and chopped off swaths of his beard. He lined up the strands on his table and braced them together with a strip of duct tape. And then he stroked it. He found that it brought him a sort of pleasure. Something new, as if someone was joining him in his home. The only disadvantage was the rigidity of the table beneath. So he put his new beard wig on a pillow. That felt much better. Rank happily sat in his chair, petting his beard wig pillow, whilst waiting to die. And it was a pleasant wait. The pain was leaving his body. He could stroke the locks more vigorously as his arthritis dissipated. Even as he sat dying, he felt more alive than ever. It occurred to him that this may be the best day he'd had in a very long time. A shame he could never repeat it. Rank looked down at his hairy new friend. It was like having a cat. He never had any pets. He was allergic. This was a nice alternative, but it wasn't very human. He didn't want a pet. He wanted someone to hold him in his dying moments. He wanted a true human companion. He wanted skin. Real human skin. Murder never entered into his mind. He could never harm anyone.
Other than himself. Well, why not?
He thought to himself. He wasn't gonna need his skin anymore. Might as well do something interesting with it on its last day on Earth. Rank began shaving his protruding belly fat, shaving it smooth. Like how he assumed a real lady would be. Using his electric carving knife, he sheared off slices of his own skin across his belly and his love handles, being careful not to cut so deep that his organs fell out. Some sheets were paper thin, others got meatier as he got dizzier. Rank bled profusely. To hold back the deluge, he slapped plastic bags on his festering wounds and then wrapped duct tape around his body to hold them in place. Rank was surprised by how little this impromptu surgery hurt. The pills were really working overtime, he thought. That was fine. As long as he still had feeling in his fingertips. Using a stapler, he fastened the strips of hair and flesh together into a single patchwork sheet of mortality. Carefully placing it over his pillow, he reclined in his chair, closed his eyes, and caressed his ersatz Eve from his rib. The feeling was unexpectedly erotic. His heart was beating faster. Sweat ran down his face. He imagined this creation was a real woman's back as the frayed ends of her hair gently flitted against his knuckles. It was bliss. He stroked it over and over again, until the flesh grew cold. After that, it was like stroking a corpse. He realized he needed to keep it warm. Perhaps microwaving it. Or maybe... Rank draped his sheet of flesh and hair over the top of the radiator. She quickly began to sizzle. He felt her. She was soft and warm, and the cast iron beneath worked as a sort of skeletal structure. To give her some dignity, he pulled a t-shirt over her. Rank gazed at her, wondering what she was thinking, but she was expressionless. In fact, she had no face at all. She deserved to have a face, he thought. He decided he loved her so much, he would share his face with her. First, he cut off his nose. He wouldn't need it anymore. It was hers now. He placed it in the center of this fleshscape, held in place with safety pins. Then he grabbed a spoon and plucked out his left eyeball, severing the optic nerve with scissors. He filled his empty socket with cotton balls to absorb the seepage. He played with the ball, rolling it between his fingers. It was firmer than he imagined, but still wet and squishy. He stapled its little tail to the back of the skin sheet, then cut a hole and pulled it through. He was hoping he could position them like an eyelid, but the eyeball just dangled out of the wound like a Christmas ornament. Finally, Rank cut another hole for her mouth. He reddened her lips by smearing their shared blood across them.
You're so beautiful. Like a pretty lady.
Rank gazed upon his creation. This monster, like a living Frankenstein beach towel. She enticed him with her bacon-scented perfume, the aroma of his own grilled flesh seeping through the bandage over his nasal crater. He knelt down and embraced his new love. Sweat and blood and affection poured out of his remaining body. His heart was beating faster and faster.
Oh, you're so soft and warm. You make me feel so happy. I love it when you hiss. I'm gonna call you Hissy. No, Sissy. I'm gonna call you Sissy. I love you. Sissy. No. I love you more. Sissy, will you marry me? Oh, Sissy, you've made me so happy. I'm dancing on the clouds with my Radiator Lady. I'm flying to the clouds with my Radiator Lady. We're flying.
Ugh, that was disgusting. Why would I make that? What's wrong with me? Jesus Christ.
I'd like to thank tonight's special guest stars, Jayden Libran and Faye Holliday. Jayden is a ridiculously talented voice artist who I wasted on this simple role. It can accurately impersonate damn near any cartoon character you can think of. There's a video of him doing over 100 Simpsons impressions, accurately, including some of the women. It's amazing! Go subscribe to his channel to see what else he can do. In fact, why are you watching this video? His are way better. Well, watch his. Jesus. I'm also extremely lucky to have Faye Holliday on board. She's another very talented actor. She's on Twitter, and if you make films, she's there, and she's available for your voice acting needs. She actually got COVID during this production. She almost died making this for you. That's how dangerous this show is. There are many more tales written and ready to plummet to Earth. You can subscribe to this channel to witness them as soon as they hit. Speaking of which, our next story is called The Cosmic Corpse Storm. And it's about aliens or some shit.